about power and power spectral density, and prior to that we will also discuss about a linear time invariant system, because all these things, if you are having linear time invariant system, then you can compute to power spectral density of output as well. If you know power spectral density of input, then easily you can compute. So that's why for that segment I have first talking about, here I am talking about linear time invariant system, then I will talk about a spectral power spectral density. So coming to outline of today's lecture, I will introduce here first what is linear time invariant system. So in LTI there are two things very important, L mean for linear and TI mean for time invariant. So those two things, you need to understand what is meaning of that. Then I will talk about Fourier transform. It will come everywhere in the spectral analysis. So that's why it is very much essential to know. And then we will discuss in detail about power spectral density, and we will try to compute it. So we will take few example. Few example would be there. And probably in next class we will discuss about first arrival process, that one is Bernoulli process. I was willing to cover this today, but I think that power spectral density, all these are very much essential as an application of previous two lectures. So that's why I come up with this lecture. So coming to that first segment, that linear time invariant system, and how we will define Fourier transform, and how we will see intuitively what is Fourier transform. Okay, we'll discuss here it. So simply, if you are taking a linear time invariant system, then first word linearity is coming. So what does linearity is talking about? Linearity says that when you take two input random process, and it can be added and scaled. We are taking two input, that means simply we are talking about linear combination of any two input random process. That means a linear combination in previous year, previous semester linear algebra, you might have already seen that. So we are taking random process x t, and we are taking another random process y t, and this one is we are talking about addition. Okay, and prior to addition we can scale, that means we are taking linear combination alpha time x t plus beta time y t. So this simply we are calling it linear combination of two signal or two random process. Here signal may be anything, so that's why it is a linear combination. Simply we can denote it. So this linear combination of may be linear combination of vector, may be linear combination of function, may be linear combination of operator, may be linear combination of signal, may be linear combination of anything. So simply you can simply call it, it is a linear combination of two things, two object. Okay, so under the linearity, what is happening, that a transformation which preserve the linear combination, then such transformation we are calling it a linear transformation. Okay, which preserve linear combination, then such transformation we are calling it a linear transformation. That is the actual definition of a linear transformation. So simplest example of a linear transformation, you can take it matrices. So matrices, if you apply matrices over a linear transformation of any two vector, then it preserve the unity. That's why matrix is a linear operator or linear transformation, you can say that. So under the linear transformation, I will give name L. L is meant for linear transformation. So if you are applying linear transformation over any linear combination of anything, any two things, so linear, under the, if L is a linear transformation, then what we will get, we will get that the corresponding the image of linear combination of any two things would be equal to linear combination of the corresponding images. So what is the image of xt? That would be L of xt. And what is the image of yt? That would be L of yt. Okay, and L of xt, L of yt, what is that? That we simply call it images, and after that we perform here same linear combination. That means we are taking same coefficient alpha and beta. It is not like that alpha and beta has been changed. So linear combination is the same, in the similar manner we have taken. Just here if you try to see, this is the ultimate definition of being linear operator. So this our linear transformation. So simply we can say that L is what? It is a linear transformation, or L preserve linearity. Simply we say that. So one example I had already mentioned, that if you are taking matrices and you apply matrices over linear combination of any two vector, linear x and y, Okay, x and y happens to two vector, then you know that under the matrix multiplication, the image of this one, it would be alpha times ax plus beta times ax, ay. Okay. So that is the ultimate example of linear transformation, what we call it, matrices. So this example you might have already seen that in your linear algebra lectures. So that is the concept. Okay, so that's where in linear transformation, if you are having any operation which is linear, then it preserves the linearity of input, linearity of input, it preserves the linearity of input. Okay, so that is the situation. So simply what is happening, that the way we are performing linear, so output simply, you what another name of this one, you call it image of xt, or you can say that output of xt. This one is image of yt, or you can say that output of yt. So you can say it like this way: if you are performing any linear combination over input in a linear system, then this same linear combination will be reflected in the output, same linear combination. So in more mathematical term, a more explicitly in mathematical term, what does it say? It says that if you are having input xt and xt dash, so image of xt is yt, image of xt dash is yt dash. So if you perform linear combination of input xt and xt dash input, so then the output of this would be linear combination of the output of the corresponding input. Same thing what we say that. So under this system, linear time invariant system, so linearity means this one. Okay, now another concept is coming, time invariant. What does it talk about, time invariant? So time invariant, simply in a more abstract way, I can say that the vector value function or vector field, there are very various names. Right hand side, like if you are having a dynamical system like this way, if you are taking a dynamical system, a continuous dynamical system or discrete dynamical. If you take continuous dynamical system, it is having the form of like this way: the x dot equal to it f of x. It is just function of a state. It is not function of time. Explicitly, it is not function of time. Definitely, time is involved here, but f is here, the right hand side. This f is not explicit function of time. So in that case, that system we are calling it time invariant system. But it is very much abstract. Nothing clear here. Okay, so in a more intuitive way, what we say that time invariant says that if we shift the input or input random process by a certain time per certain time period, if we are shifting by a certain time period, then output will be also shifted with the same time period. Like here, if you are having a linear time invariant system, right now we don't know what is that system, just we know that it is a linear time invariant system which transform the input xt to output yt. And suppose if you are shifting this linear time invariant system by a time shift tau, okay, then why the output would be also shifted by the same amount. That means in image of this one would be this. So what is this one? How we are getting this one? This we are getting by shifting this one by amount tau. And how we got this input? This input is related with this one. How we got it? By performing a time shift of tau. So that is the meaning of time invariant. Okay. So we will talk about if you are having a linear time invariant system, then the solution of linear time invariant system is coming through convolution. You might have already seen in control system. Are you aware of that approach or not? Anyone? So suppose we are having a linear time invariant system here, LTI. This is the linear time invariant system, and I am taking an input xt is the input. Xt is the input. And yt is the output. Then tell me, what is the relation between yt and xt. How we can get yt from xt? How we can get? Anyone? HT. Tell me what is this HT? Anyone? What is this HT? You mentioned that transfer function. So, is it having another name? You say that it is convolution between input. So convolution generally we denote it by x steric h of t. So simply you can say that convolution we can represent it integral in general sense integral minus infinity to infinity of x tau h of t minus tau dt. Okay, this is the ultimate way to compute. Here you know xt. What about ht? How we get ht? Anyone? What is ht? You mentioned that transfer function, but how you got ht? Anyone would like to say that? Any idea? No. Yeah, you are talking about estimation of transfer function. Estimation or computation of transfer function. Apart from that, how you can get? Take benefit of delta function. Do you know? You can compute HT by inputting delta function as an input function. Do you know or not? That's why it is this HT is having another name that we call it impulse response. Why? Because it is the response. Response means output. Output response. So here HT, H is actually response if you are putting input as a delta function. So if you here just substitute x equal to delta function, in that case yt would be what? Just what is the convolution of h with delta function? That means you are taking delta function as an input. So what is the convolution of delta function with h function? Anyone? It would be h of t. Okay, but you know that here, suppose here this one is the input, it is, we have taken this one is input, and this one is what? It is the definition of output, the output we are getting. So if you are taking input as a delta, then whatever output we are getting, that one is actually transfer function ht. That's why it is having another name that we call it impulse response. Is it clear to everyone why it is impulse response? Impulse response, it is not equal to transfer function directly. We don't say impulse ht is impulse response in sense that when we take input as a delta function, then we observe that response is equal to h of t. That's why h of t in general perspective, we are taking general input, then the solution can be written as a convolution, like convolution of transfer function and h, or say better, you don't call transfer function directly. Now it would be a impulse response, but a little bit confusion is there. Impulse response, that means it should be response, but it is response definitely with respect to delta as an input. So that is the approach to define output through convolution. Okay, so I think it would be clear to everyone. So same thing I have explained here. So always play with symmetric representation of convolution. As much as you know about convolution, that would help to understand the concept better. So always try to explore everything related to convolution. So this is the approach. Okay, and convolution is a symmetric operator. So that's why there is no issue whether you are taking x first or h first, and that one is not going to affect much. So it is the output for any general input x. Generally, but remember that H is impulse response coming from delta function as an input. Okay, so this is the ultimate explicit form of what we call it, explicit form of output. We need to know this, and we know this one is the impulse response. We can always get it, and always we can get it from the given system or given relation. We can always able to compute this one. Okay, this we can come up and we can easily find output. So here we call ht as the, so ht sometimes you can call it is system response, but it is coming with respect to delta function. If you take input is delta function, then it becomes response. So that's why another name of ht is also impulse response. So impulse response means you know better. So that is meaning of that. A system response, that means you need to study system. So it may be a little bit black box kind of thing, but it is this one, this name, it is saying it is more explicit. So that is there. So then what we observe that, so solution is simply that I have already explained it again. So that means if you are taking input as a delta function, then your output would be this transfer function ht, and hence we are calling it ht as an impulse response, response of impulse input. So that the name is already hidden there. In impulse response itself describe about what is h. Okay, now I will take very simplest example of a time invariant system as a moving average process. Moving. So what does this talk about? So if you are taking a discrete time system, Zn is defined like this way. Time is discrete, so that's why I have taken t equal to n, natural number, simple countable time index I have taken. And we will call Zn is a white noise. So what is definition of white noise? We don't have to worry about what kind of probability law it will have. It will definitely have certain probability law, but apart from that probability law, it must satisfy that mean of this random process would be zero. Variance would be fixed. It would be sigma square. Because here mean is zero, that's where variance just becomes second moment. And also, the autocorrelation for any two different time instant n1 and n2 must be zero. That would be. So if there is a discrete time random process which is satisfying these three conditions. One is zero mean, second is constant variance, and third is zero correlation, zero autocorrelation for any two time sample, time instant. Then simply we call that one is a white noise process. Now suppose if you are having a white noise process, then we can define a moving average process of order one. Order one means just one shift, so n to n plus 1 or n minus 2 n. So that one shift, there is just one shift, that we call it of order one. So we are defining a moving average process as, what is meaning of, there are two things, moving world and average world. Moving means there is a movement, and what is meaning of average? That means take any two consecutive term of the random process or member of the random process and take average of that. So there are various way to represent average. This one is the weighted average, or you can also there say that it is convex combination. So what is meaning of that? So if you are taking b not equal to 0.5 and b1 equal to 0.5, then it becomes what, zn plus zn minus 1 divided by 2. If you are taking b0 equal to 0.5 and b1 equal to 0.5, then simply as usual average, what we have already seen that. But apart from that, If you convert that average into weighted form, so simply what is the criteria it is satisfying V0 at V1? So if you sum these two, V0 at V1, 0.5 plus 0.5, it would be equal to 1. So why not we generalize it to weighted average, where V0 may be any value between 0 to 1, and V1 would be also any value between 0 and 1. But remember that as defining average 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2 happens to be equal to 1, then B0 and B1 also is satisfying the same rule, that B0 plus B1 equal to 1. So that's why we are calling this the average. And there is a movement here, there is the sum of two conjugative, so that's why it is moving average. So if you are defining moving average of a white noise process, then simply it is a difference equation. Easily you can say that it is a sequential form, it is a difference equation. Okay, so this difference equation or discrete time process, it is just a linear time invariant system. It is linear, you can say that the coefficient linearity, that means you have to see the exponent of coefficient of the term. So exponent, this one is exponent is 1, exponent is 1, so by default it would be linear. So it is a linear time, simplest linear time invariant system, what I would like to say that. So moving average process is just the average of successive value of the white noise process, so it is smoother than the white one. You can see that the orange line, orange sample path, that one sample path we have taken, that means one realization of the white noise we have taken, this is the white noise. We can see that it is there are kink, more number of kinks in the path, you can observe that. But if you are defining moving average, then just number of kink has been reduced, you can easily see that. So moving average, simply you can say that it try to smooth out the given random process. If you are defining moving average through the terms of the random process, then again moving average would be also a random process. But what is one benefit of that moving average? It is just smoothing the given random process. So that is the criteria. So it is, again you can say that it is a this moving average, it is a linear time invariant system. It is why, because it is coming with respect to one dynamic equation, that happens to be a difference equation. And everyone might be aware of, have you in control theory, you may already have idea of two different form of a dynamical system or control problem. One in continuous form, continuous time, another in discrete time. Have you gone through that or not? Two different representation of a dynamical system in control system. Anyone? Do you know or not? Don't know. Have you, whether the control system has been taught or not? So what about a state space equation? Do you know that, whether that have been covered or not? So there itself you need to know that it might be introduced. So this one is x dot equal to ax plus b u. It is linear time invariant system. And y equal to C x plus d u. Okay, this one is continuous form control system time, a state space representation of control system in continuous time. Then this one is continuous time, simply LTI, continuous time LTI, LTI linear time invariant system. Okay, there is a discrete same from here, there is an equivalent discrete time LTI. What is that? Discretely in form of difference equation or situational form you have to write. So in, you know that discrete, when you say, what does it talk about? It talk about dx by dt. X dot is what? The time derivative of the signal, dx by dt. Okay, so can you approximate this one? It through difference. So a differential thing, you can always approximate it through difference. So how we approximate it? You can approximate it like this way, x of t plus delta or t plus tau minus x of t divided by t plus tau minus that means tau. This difference form, it is the difference representation. You know that from even from high school you might be aware of that. So that's why if you are trying to observe more discretized pattern of the given continuous interval, then this would take the form of like this way, x t plus 1. Suppose tau equal to 1, if you are taking tau equal to a steps width is 1, then what would be this? It would be xt plus 1 would be equal to, I may write a, otherwise you can write a dash, something else, a dash would be, otherwise just a, same thing I am writing it, there is no any issue. But this a is different from this a. So here it would be a time xt plus b time ut. Here x of t, here it would be x of t, x is continuous function of time. And u is also continuous function of time, but here x is a discrete function, time is coming in discrete fashion, and y t, the observation at time t, it is c time x t plus d time u t. So this one is the, both are calling dynamic LTI system, a state space representation, but it is in continuous time, this one is discrete time. So I think everyone might have gone through this one, that is the representation of a state space representation of control system. Now I will talk about another important part in order to understand power spectral density, that one is Fourier series. So just everyone know that Fourier series. So here definitely if in line in a, for a time invariant system, yt can be determined through the output, yt also can be determined through output, that Fourier transform, the Fourier transform of the input, it is coming like so. So first we need to know what is the Fourier transform of input signal. So Fourier transform, we define it, that means we multiply the given signal with a kernel function. This you can say that it is a kernel function, but I would like to give another name to this. So it is just a dot product between this integral, it is dot product in infinite dimensional space, a square integral function. In a square integral function, we are defining dot product like this way, it is again a dot product. So that extension, if someone is aware of dot product in finite dimensional space, it is very easy to find dot product between, suppose you are taking any two vector a and b, that dot product in finite dimensional space, we write it like this way, just a transpose b, and a and b are vectors, so a transpose b, it would be just equal to sum of product of individual entry, okay, entries like a2 times corresponding entries, place wise, point to coordinate wise entry, what we call it, a n time, if a and b both happens to be n dimensional, in this way we compute, okay. But if you replace this a by a function and b by another function g, in this case the inner product between these two would be an integral from a to b. A to b is what? It is the domain over which these two functions are defined. So here the signal is actually defined from minus infinity to infinity, so that's why we have taken this one. So here it would be inner product between these two functions would be just integral of f of t product and gt and with respect to time. And someone is willing to see the x derivation, how this we are getting from here, you can watch few video lecture from my linear algebra course. There I have already mentioned given derivation that in the linear algebra course, you can see that thing there, okay. So you can see that. So simply I would like to say that what is meaning of inner product. So I always say that actually Fourier transform is inner product between this special function with this signal xt, okay. Now what is this special function? Actually this special function is actually eigen function of this Fourier transform. It is eigen function. So everyone might be aware of what is meaning of eigen value and eigen vector. Anyone would like to recall what is eigen value and eigen vector? Do you know or not? Anyone? Just recall, what is eigenvalue and eigenvector? These are very simple things. You need to know that you are from EC, so every time such thing will come. What is eigenvalue and eigenvector? Do you know or not? Anyone just try to recall it? Because you don't know. Okay, then what is that eigenvalue? Because just try to answer. It is very simple. That it is having a geometry. Which one is it? Which having a geometry? I always assume that must be visualizable to you, and hence it would be very easy to understand that. So that's why it is very easy to visualize that. So here, if you are having an eigenvector matrix, so what matrix do? Suppose if you are taking two-dimensional vector and you are taking 2x2 matrix. So 2x2 matrix, what does it do? So if you are taking any vector x, suppose you are taking this is the vector x. So the matrix will A will what it will do? It will either rotate, it will either scale or project. So various things. So under this point AX, it will be transformed to another point. Call it Y. This is Y is actually equal to A times X. So X has been transformed to Y, X vector has been transformed to Y vector Y under the transformation A. So A is a transformation. Now what is happening that is sometime it happens that if you are taking a very special vector V, and if you apply the matrix A over B, it is not changing the direction of V. It is the same direction V is there. So if you are observing under the transformation A, if you are observing a specific vector whose direction is not changed or altered by the transformation, then such a special vector we are calling it eigenvector. And the corresponding magnitude through which it has been scaling is possible. Scaled because this is a scalar quantity. So this scale quantity, this quantity we are calling it eigenvector, and the scale amount or magnitude we are calling it eigenvalue. So this one V, this special vector V, we are calling it eigenvector. And this lambda, this scaled amount, we are calling it eigenvalue. So first you need to define eigen vector, then eigenvalue. So more algebraically, if you simply simplify it, then it will say that A times V, if you bring everything left hand side, lambda times, you can put it identity matrix. So if you multiply any identity matrix with a vector, you will get the same vector. It is equal to 0. You can put it. So what you do? You take V common from left. So the coefficient matrix, it becomes A minus lambda times I equal to V. Now this eigenvector, what we a special vector we have taken, so this one is satisfied by default by zero. So we don't want zero kind of vector. This a special vector must be non-zero vector. So if you suppose we are putting a condition here, this eigenvector must be a non-zero vector. Under this, we know here, if this matrix apply over V, and V happens to be a special vector as an eigenvector of A, and then it map this to zero, then what is being criteria in order to get non-trivial solution, non-zero solution? What condition we need to put it here? Anyone from this solving system of equation, anyone know what kind of condition it would have? When you will get non-zero solution for this matrix equation system? Anyone? No idea. You should recall all these are very simple. So it will have a non-zero solution. V must be non-zero when this coefficient matrix of V is a singular matrix. What does it? So it is not equal to zero. It simply implies that singular matrix. What is meaning of singular matrix? That means determinant of that coefficient matrix A minus lambda I happens to be zero. It must be zero. And this corresponding equation, we are calling it characterizing equation and characterization equation. And when you solve this, you will get value of lambda. From there, substitute back here, you will get non by solving for V, you will get eigenvector. So that is the approach you might have already seen that. So all you know that how to compute eigenvalue, eigenvector. Again, recall it again. So that's where here same feature. So here simply with respect to infinite dimensional vector, simply call it function happens to be infinite dimensional vector. Just in a very layman way, I'm trying to say that what is function? Function happens to be infinite dimensional vector. And if there is an infinite dimensional vector, then also we need to define inner product. So if you're defining inner product, then you can say that what is this concept is coming? It is actually eigen function of that equivalent to eigenvector, eigen function of the Fourier transform. So that is the meaning of that. This way we are defining. All these are having very much geometric. Okay, so there are three important things regarding Fourier transform. What are those? So Fourier transform, it is talking about, it is a definite transformation from T space to frequency space, time space to frequency space, but it is an orthogonal mapping, orthogonal transformation. Second characterization is thing of important thing is that this function we call it is an eigen function of the Fourier transform. And also what is happening that if you perform convolution in time in order to get output of a LTI system, then same convolution operator would be converted into multiplication in frequency space. That's why convolution is dealing with integral or summation. Discrete convolution is summation and continuous convolution is integration. So always integration and what we call it summation happens to be more complicated than multiplication. So that's why you always go to frequency domain, perform thing, get back to time domain. So that's where these three important things regarding Fourier transform, but we are getting it. So one simple is that the proof I have already taken. So how we say that this one is the eigen function of this Fourier transform. So what you do? Take xt, this signal as this function, and define the convolution. Convolution or define simply convolution, the output in convolution term. So what you will observe that here, it would be simply through convolution, it is coming through convolution operator, what we observe, what input we have taken, and finally we are getting, there is, we know that here, h of omega t, xt, again xt would come here, it is coming like this way, h of omega t. Simply, I would like to say that here easily you need to simplify it here. So it will easily, just you simplify it here and just convert, apply the concept of Fourier transform. So here if you simplify it, it would be what? Break it to this exponential function. It is just keep, you are integrating with respect to tau only. So keep e to the power minus j omega tau inside the integral and this quantity take it out. Take it out, e to the power j omega t, take it out. So that's way, what is e to the power j omega t? Remaining thing would be h of this one. So what does that will map to Fourier transform of xt, that transfer function time x t. This signal is coming out. This signal is coming out. So just it is just multiplication. There is no change what we observe that. So that's why here we call it. It is a Fourier transform of eigenfunction of the Fourier transform. Due to that, yeah, so a basic property of convolution is that convolution is time domain is equivalent to multiplication in Fourier transform. That means that we can see it like this way. So apply here, further apply. Once you perform this one was the relation between input and output through this specific output. And from here, if you apply further the Fourier transform, what you observe, the output is just product of the Fourier transform H and signal given signal ST, H and given signal ST. So that simple product relation what we are getting it here. And do we have time? Actually it is already above 45 minutes. So in next class probably I will discuss about power of spectral density. It is very much important in order to understand understand random signal. So we'll discuss in detail in tomorrow class. Okay, day after tomorrow class.